Welcome to Rejoice Online. We're glad that you're joining us for worship and want you to welcome you to our online community. To contact us, please visit our website at www.rejoicefrisco.com or feel free to email me at adam@rejoicefrisco.com. We believe that all are welcome here without exception. Please know that Christ is present with you wherever you are at and whatever situation you find yourself in. God's grace is boundless. Let us praise God in song as we worship together.
According to St. John, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found the one about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said to him, "Truly, here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus said, "And I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to them, "Very truly I tell you, you will see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. Lord God, may we go where you desire us to go. May we be open to those who you place in our midst. May we let go of the things that we set up to where we judge others and we set up these barriers between us and them, thinking that we are righteous and they are unrighteous. Lord God, help us to see as you see. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I look at how we're going to go through seasons well in advance. And so I'd set these readings a long time ago, and I knew that throughout this time of Epiphany, I wanted to take this opportunity and go through the book of Jonah, which is, you know, it's one of those books that's both simple and at the same time has some really, really deep points to it. It's one of the first stories I think that most children learn because, of course, you know, here's Jonah getting swallowed by the great big fish. But it also has some really, you know, it really has in this really short book a very important message about who God is and who we as God's people are to be, and how God acts when we don't act right. And you know, I think this is an important thing in our community and our world right now, because we've gotten to the point, or at least in certain parts of our society, we've gotten to the point where we don't hear one another anymore. You know, a person who thinks differently than us, and we live in a world that's broken into camps. So are you a Democrat or are you a Republican? And if you're a Democrat, you think this way. If you're a Republican, you think this way. And often the two sides don't talk to each other. And you'll also find churches that are all one way or all the other way, and they speak that common language, and I've always tried to work in the middle. You know, because it's not that we have this group of people who are blessed by God and this group of people who are not. We all have this part. And this is one of the things that I love about our symbolism of baptism. You know, we are all baptized children of God. We all have this worth, this place before God. And yet I sometimes think that we fall into that same trap that Nathanael falls into in our gospel today. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Well, apparently something can. Apparently God's son, Jesus, can come out of Nazareth. And yet, based on, you know, the way in which we like to prejudge, Nathanael could have very easily said, you know, I don't care what you say, Philip. I don't care how good you say this person is. He's one of those people. You know, and Jonah falls into that same fault. Now, perhaps we can give Jonah a little bit of grace here. So God is sending Jonah to Nineveh. And when God is sending Jonah to Nineveh, Nineveh has just conquered Israel. So Nineveh is the capital of Assyria. They've just conquered Israel. And so God says to Jonah, go to the people who are your enemies. Sounds kind of like Jesus saying, love your enemies. And that's a hard thing to do. And Jonah doesn't want to do this because Jonah knows what God is like. Jonah knows that, you know, God, there is a good chance that if they show the least bit of repentance, you're going to relent. You're going to forgive. And why would I want to give them that chance? Let them be condemned. Let them be, cursed. Let them bear whatever punishment they did. They did this to us. You do this to them. And so Jonah gets on a ship and goes in the opposite direction. Now, I had no idea for most of my life where Nineveh was. Nineveh is in modern-day Iraq. Where Jonah is trying to go to is the tip of Spain. It's as far as they know they can go in the opposite direction. And so he gets on this ship. And the sailors on this ship are not Jewish. They're not Hebrews. So and we get this in the story. They're worshiping other gods. But they take Jonah, they take him on this journey, and they go out to sea, and then God throws the wind on the sea. God throws this storm, and the sailors do everything they can. So they start throwing their cargo into the sea. They do everything they can, and then finally the captain comes down and finds Jonah asleep and says, "Why are you asleep? Come up. Come pray to your gods. You know, we've already been praying to our gods. You pray to your God. Maybe that'll help." And then as a last-ditch effort, they say, "Well, let's figure out who's responsible for this." So they draw lots. So in a way, they gamble. They try and figure out, you know, who's the one who their God is angry at them by chance. And so the lot falls to Jonah, and they say, "Well, who are you?" He says, "Well, I'm a Hebrew. I worship the Lord, the God of the heavens. The one who created the heavens and the earth and the sea. And now the sailors are afraid, but they also are not willing to give up on Jonah. So they do everything they can. They've already thrown their cargo into the sea. They've already lost money on this voyage, but now they're trying to row with all their ability to get to shore so that they don't have to give up on his life. And he's told them that you're going to have to throw me into the sea. But they try everything they can to not do that. And so at this last-ditch effort, they cry out to Jonah's God. They cry out to the God of Israel, "Lord, don't hold this man's blood against us. We're trying to do everything we can to save his life." And so they finally relent. They throw him into the sea. And Jonah sinks down, and God refuses to give up on this reluctant prophet who doesn't want to do what God asks him to do. You know, I think there are a lot of people who fit into that place that Jonah finds himself that day. You know, I would and again, Jonah would rather die than go to Nineveh. Jonah would rather die than see his enemy forgiven. Jonah would rather die than see them have a chance at life. Somehow they become less than human. Somehow they become not worthy of my time, of my words, of my effort, of my God's grace. You know, the earliest sin in the Bible, when Adam and Eve are in the garden, the temptation that the serpent gives to Eve is, "You will be like God. You will be like God, being able to judge between good and evil." And I think we try to do that an awful lot. I'm the one who gets to decide who's good and who's bad, who's right, who's wrong, who deserves grace, who deserves punishment, who is in, who is out, who God loves and who God hates. But when we make those decisions, then God, who we worship, is like looking in the mirror. But the God who we come to know through the Lord, the God of Israel, the God who we come to know in Jesus Christ, the God who we come to know through God's Holy Spirit, you know, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the one who is, as Jonah's going to tell us later in the book, a God who is slow to anger and quick to forgive. That God often loves the very people who we may not want to love at that point. And that's the scandal of grace. That's why grace can be so hard. You know, because God not only loves me, but God loves my enemies. Christ not only died for me, Christ died for those who disagree with me, who may speak poorly of me, who may try and run my name through the dirt, or who may at times have caused me harm. Now, I'm not going to say that we don't, that there aren't consequences to what we or other people do. That's not what this is about. But I do think that we are all too quick sometimes to write people off and say, you know what? They don't deserve my love, and so they must not deserve God's love. And yet, God refuses to give up on them, and God refuses to give up on us. And often, it's amazing how many times that it'll be the very people who we think we have the least to learn from, who may show us what God is really like. So I'm going to go back to the sailors for just a minute. These sailors who worshiped other gods, who did things the best way they could, but they're the ones who try everything they can to save Jonah. They're the ones who, once they know Jonah's God's name, call upon that God by name, and then once the seas are quiet, they offer up praise and sacrifice to not their gods, but the God of Israel. Sometimes the people who we don't expect to see, they see. And sometimes we who, you know, may gather together every week for worship and may hear these stories over and over and over again, we may need to have our eyes opened, our ears cleaned out, our hearts softened. You know, God loves this world. God loves God's people, no matter how reluctant we may be to share that grace with others. But God also loves those who we share that grace with and those who we do not. So, Lord God, continue to not give up on us. Continue to be patient with us, reshaping us to follow you instead of trying for us to try to craft you to be like us. Lord, may we give up that self-righteousness where we want to say that we're the ones who have all the right answers, when it's we who should indeed be listening to you. And one final thing from this first part of the book of Jonah. So if there's one thing I've learned about God's call in my life, it's that God will outweigh you. When you say no, sometimes God says, we'll see. God has a lot more patience than we do. God refuses to give up on Jonah. God didn't give up on Nathaniel. I do believe God doesn't give up on us. So as we go through this time, as we enter into a world where we find people who we disagree with, may we ask God to continue to give us a heart like God's, where we can learn to love those who would call us their enemy. And we can no longer call them our enemy because we know that they too are one loved by God. Amen. Thank you.
thank you again for joining us. May God's peace rest upon you and strengthen you as we try to live into the gifts that we have first been given. Remember that God loves you, and we are all called to mirror that love to the world around us. Go in love.